الله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون والحمد لله الذي من علينا بمحمد صلى الله عليه وآله وبآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم ومبغضيهم وغاصبي حقوقهم من ليلنا هذا إلى يوم الدين صلاة
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
We decided that the subject which was given for discussion in the form of seminar be amalgamated and integrated with this Wafat night. The fact is that on that particular subject during last 2 months I have spoken twice already. One in this Imambara when the madrasa arranged Islamic view and fatwa of mujtahideen on medical ethics, and the second one when it was arranged at the Darut Tabligh, where the doctors and many professionals attended. They gave their view and then we guided the people there as to what was Islam's ruling on all those medical problems. Those of you who really wish to see them in detail can ask for the video which was there, and you will understand what actually I have said. Tonight I'm just going to repeat a few salient features because I have got to finish in my time. What we have to understand is that the madhab of Shia Ithna Ashari has a fiqh, has a law. Islam has laws, and we, the Shia Ithna Ashari, our laws emanate from two principal sources. One is Quran, which is Kitabullah. Another is Hadith, if it is proved to be authentic. If the hadith is proved to be not authentic, we don't accept it. That means if somebody just imputes a lie against our Prophet and said the Prophet said this, while the Prophet never said, if it is proved by the ulama that this is Va'ifus Sanad, or it is against the teaching of Quran and Majid, then of course such a hadith will not be accepted. And our Imam alayhi salam have guided us that whenever you receive a hadith, compare it to Quran and Majid. If it really tallies and agrees with the teaching of Quran, then it is from us. Otherwise, throw it to the wall. This is what Imam alayhi salam said. We could not have spoken those words. The only difference is that while other Muslim brothers rely, as far as hadith is concerned, on a single source, and that is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, we rely upon the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, and therefore we have other 12 sources extra where Ahlul Bayt have spoken. Of course, Ahlul Bayt have spoken and conveyed to us that which was said by the Prophet. But when it comes from them, then we are richer as far as our treasure of hadith is concerned. Taking a practical example, Ahlul Sunnah brothers have got 6 authentic books. They call them 6 authentic books. As-Sihah al-Sittah. They have Sahih Bukhari, they have Sahih Muslim, they have Ibn Majah, they have Tirmidhi, they have Sunan Ibn Dawood. All these are called Sahih books. And we also use those books. Because if there is any hadith which has been correctly reported, we will take it, regardless whether it comes from Bukhari or Muslim or wherever. But they call them authentic. We don't call any book authentic except Qur'an Majeed. There is no authentic book on earth except Qur'an. Well, they call it authentic. Now, put together all the hadith reported in these six books, add them together, it is lesser than 1 hour Usul-e-Kafi. Because in Usul-e-Kafi we have more than 20,000 hadith, while theirs you put together all, they don't come to that, because their source is limited. Our source is wider, and we take from Aimma Ishmael alayhi salam also. But there happens now, these hadith are of many types, and Qur'an and Majeed also. For example, Muhakkik al-Ardabili is just one example. I mean, there are many, but I'm giving an example. Has written one book, Ayatul Ahkam, in which he discusses only those ayats of Qur'an from which he takes the hukum of fiqh. And there are 500. 500 ayats of Qur'an he has taken, and he calls the book Ayatul Ahkam, those verses which indicate hukm ilahi. Because Qur'an has got akhlaqiyat, Qur'an has got historical anecdotes, Qur'an has got maw'idha, Qur'an has got so many subjects on it. He only has taken fiqh from it and chosen 500 ayats. Many other ulama have chosen more. Qur'an Majeed provides the source for the law, and hadith supports and elucidates it. To put together, we have what we call fiqh. Then, of course, there are other subsidiary things I'm not discussing tonight. But these two things are our principles, sources. Now, there can be certain things which did not happen in the time of the Prophet, which did not exist. Banks, commerce, the way it is being conducted today, medicine, for example, there are so many other things which did not exist in the time of the Prophet, but it exists today. We have got to find the ruling of Sharia. Does Sharia keep quiet on this? Or does it guide? Now that guidance which Sharia will give on any commercial law, insurance, banking, interest element in the banks, commission, and all other laws, inheritance, and even medical ethics today. Yes. We have got to see what the mujtahideen will say. Now the mujtahideen cannot give their own fatwa from the pocket, because they are responsible to Allah and to Aimma, to the Prophet. They have got to give answer on the Day of Judgment. So they will first take Qur'an and Majeed, and then they will take Hadith, and based on these two principal sources, they'll find an analogy, and from analogy they will give a ruling to say that this is the ruling of Sharia. They can't get out of the framework of Qur'an and Hadith. Impossible. This is the thing. Now, what has happened? Since I have been told to speak on medical ethics and Islam, confining myself to that, today the question is of, first and foremost, which used to be for the last 30 years, birth control, or use of contraceptives. Many thought and still think that in the time of the Prophet this did not exist, but they are mistaken. The practice of controlling the birth is as old as 3,000 years. Our Prophet has been only 1,400 years ago. So people have been practicing this contraceptive in their own way, their own methods for the last 3,000 years. But they had their own crude methods. some refined methods, which are in use even today. One of them was what is called in their medical terms coitus interruptus, which is called in Arabic azl, withdrawal of the husband at the time of ejaculation. This is called azl. This is mentioned even in all our books of fiqh. And you can see in Al-Urwatul Wuthqa, the Qadim, Sayyid Qadim Yazdi has mentioned also the hukum of, what is the hukum of Al-Azl, the husband withdrawing at the time of ejaculation, and he has ruled that this is allowed provided wife and husband both are agreeable. So the idea of preventing birth has been there. What has happened is that as with the lapse of time, now there are so many ways of contraception, so many modes of contraception. We have a pill and we have this and we have that. All these things by Sharia have been allowed. All mujtahideen have allowed. In principle, contraception is permissible and the modes used are all permissible. Except one thing, you cannot make a man or a woman, that means husband and wife, permanently disabled so that they can never produce. That is haram, even if they have 6, 7 children or 9 or 10, except when advised by the doctor that if you now will conceive and deliver, you will die, or it will be harmful to your health or to the health of the child to be born. Otherwise, it is not jais, permanent disability. Now, when we go to the doctors, doctors have got, just like mujtahideen, opinions and opinions. Some doctors tell us that, well, we can do this, but it is a reversible process. And some say it is irreversible process. If it is irreversible, that means once you made disabled, vasectomy, then you cannot reproduce because the travel of sperm is impossible. Or it is a dangerous thing, then it is haram. Similarly for the ladies, if there is any of such operation. Therefore, this is something where we call gray area, or rather no-go area, because we do not know and the professionals don't tell us exactly what is happening. Therefore, we will take a mujtahid's opinion, and if he says it is haram, and it is haram, permanent disability. And the second thing which is haram is abortion. And in Sharia, abortion means when the conception has taken place, even if it is a day old, when the eggs have been fertilized by human sperm and it has already set on the fallopian tubes, that is conception. Day one, to abort it is haram. Even if it is, in the modern medical era, possible to diagnose that the child is disabled, you cannot abort it. And even, God forbid, it is there by rape, you cannot. For the principle in Islam is that life belongs to Allah and not to you. This is the reason why in no circumstances suicide is allowed. For ruh, and this is amanat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And God forbid, and we pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not bring us into that sort of situation. If a rape occurs, the child born of a rape is not haramzada, is not illegitimate, it is a legitimate child. Try to understand.